So I'm here to say a little something about the trials and tribulations we've been having in the UK, England and Wales specifically, over the retention of DNA from individuals for the use of the police. So I'm just going to say something quickly about the use of DNA by the police in the UK and why then we've had this need recently for change, and then talk about the government's approach to that change. I will be talking obviously about our ex-government because of course it was, we had a general election in mid-May and they lost. So we now have a new government, which I might, if we have a chance at the end, say something about their new approach. Have a look at the proposals they put together for change and the evidence they use to support these proposals, and then make a plea perhaps at the end for whether we can have our balance back, please. So just to say something, I'm sure you're all aware of a lot of this about the origins of forensic DNA, because of course England will be always first to tell you that we invented this technology. This is Alec Jeffries here. His parents had great foresight in taking photos of him aged six with his new telescope. So he discovered this kind of barcoding effect whilst doing some research on walruses and rabbits. And he first used this technique on humans in immigration disputes. So the Home Office got to hear about this technology and thought, aha, we can use this in immigration disputes to prove or disprove biological relationships between people who were claiming refugee status or asylum. It got labelled at that time genetic fingerprinting. It's not called that anymore. Of course, we don't use this technology now. But of course, it had the wonderful ability then to piggyback on the trust that was already placed in fingerprinting. Its first use in crime was in 1985, when we had a series of rapes in some small villages, which led to the false confession of a young individual, and we managed to use DNA testing then to prove that he wasn't actually the perpetrator, and subsequently, after quite a lengthy investigation, we did find Colin Pitchfork, who was the real rapist. So since 1985 then, and this Colin Pitchfork case, we've had what's been called a forensic DNA revolution. This has consisted mainly of scientific and technological reform and also significant legal reforms. We had the establishment in 1995 in the UK, another world first, of the National DNA Database, so we could store DNA profiles of individuals. Since then, the use of DNA has risen dramatically, so that it's now called by police officers an integral part of the criminal justice system. The National DNA Database itself has seen massive growth, so we now in the UK have the largest proportion of our population on a DNA database in the world. And of course, all of this has been underpinned by significant government investment. They've spent at least over £300 million on this. And of course, we've had the police increasing their use of DNA, particularly in volume crimes, so in burglaries, car thefts, and so forth. The media have also done their part in advertising and promoting this DNA to the public, who've lapped it all up. So we regularly see cases, the same cases very often, played over and over again, where DNA was important. These cases are very interesting in that they don't actually help the government's cause at all, any of them. And of course, the media have actually put their big fat foot in it with the serial killer case and their reporting of that, because they wonderfully reported that DNA actually wasn't of any use in particular in catching the criminal, because he put the dead bodies in water, so it washed the DNA away. Wonderfully, they told the public that you want to kill some people, shove them in water, gets rid of the DNA, it's wonderful. We've subsequently had a new serial killer just last month, who was a criminology PhD student, which is a bit scary. He left all of his bodies in the river. And of course, the media have just put two and two together, and one of them actually said, I wonder if that's because we told them to put bodies in water and then the DNA is useless. Anyway, so what is our national DNA database then? Simply a database of DNA that's collected from individuals, also material that's been left at crime scenes or from victims. This biological material then is used to produce a DNA profile, which looks a bit like this. So it's really just these series of numbers are stored in a 20-number code on the computer. And we also, at the moment, retain the biological material as well. So in the UK, we have about 7% of our population on the DNA database. There is a replication rate in the database of about 13%. So there's about 5.5 million profiles, but they reckon it's about 5 million individuals. We have at least 50,000 citizens added each month to the database. And of course, we mustn't forget that this is a police database with police information run by the police. It's overseen by the National Policing Improvement Agency. And it's overseen by the police and used by the police. It's solely a police operation. In Australia, likewise, we have the National Criminal Investigation DNA database, and as you can see, a great deal smaller, but the principles are the same. So, in terms of legal reform, between 1995 and 2003, basically we had a series of laws that then expanded the list of those from whom a sample could be taken, so that it's now arrestees. We downgraded the authority required to sanction sampling. We permitted samples and profiles to be retained indefinitely. We increased access to the database and increased the uses of the database. And we also put in place provisions to allow for the use of DNA for identifying body parts and bodies and so forth. But the DNA database has never actually been subject to its own legislation. So the law as it still stands at the moment in the UK, police can take and keep DNA and fingerprints and photographs without consent from all people who've been arrested for a recordable offence. A recordable offence can be really practically anything except really minor motoring offences, littering and so forth. Basically, it's anything the police have to write down. This can then be used for the purposes related to the prevention or detection of crime, the investigation of an offence or the conduct of a prosecution. There's been a lot of concern over that use, the prevention of crime, because that could leave the door open to quite a lot of uses. The DNA database obviously also has volunteers on the DNA database. People can volunteer to have their DNA on it, largely when there's mass intelligence screens or you've been a witness or a victim of a crime, you can have your DNA kept. And also minors are kept on there. If they're arrested, if they're over the age of 10, they can have their DNA kept regardless. And it used to be the case that parents could consent otherwise if they were under 10, but the government have since changed that, so under 10-year-olds shouldn't be on there. So we've had all these reforms and we ended up getting this enormous DNA database. Then around mid-2005, we started getting some ethical concerns coming up. People started taking note of this database and this growing database, and some worries started appearing. One of the first major reports into it, the Nuffield Council on Bioethics, they looked at the ethical issues, and they said there hadn't been really any public debate around these extensions to police powers, and that the use of DNA in such circumstances still remains sensitive. And they outlined some values that should be incorporated in consideration about when looking at this DNA database, such as liberty, privacy, autonomy, equality, and informed consent. And they basically called for more supporting evidence and for a greater debate to be had about this, especially over the retention of innocent DNA, so people who hadn't been convicted of any offences. But meanwhile, we had a court case going through the English courts called S and Marper. S was a young offender or wasn't an offender because he hadn't been convicted of any offence, and Marper, a middle-aged gentleman. They'd both been arrested, had their DNA taken, and then subsequently weren't convicted of any offence. So they applied to their local police force to have their DNA removed from the DNA database, and it was refused. Largely, most police forces just refuse any request. So they went to courts claiming that this breached their privacy rights under the European Convention of Human Rights, Article 8, and it was also discriminatory, invoking Article 14. This went all the way up to the House of Lords in the UK, and they almost unanimously, there was one dissenting judge, said that if this attention breached privacy, then it was only a bit of a breach, and anyway, it was justified because we were fighting crime, so we could live with that bit of a breach. So this case then went to the European Court of Human Rights, and they actually reached a very different view. So just as a quick reminder, I'm sure you all know that Article 8, everyone has the right to respect to his private life. There shall be no interference by public authority with the exercise of this right, except such as in accordance with the law and is necessary in a democratic society for the prevention or disorder of crime. And privacy under the European Convention has a very broad interpretation. There isn't an exhaustible definition of privacy. So the government were very, very confident. A week or so before the judgment came out, I was having tea with one of the main architects of the government case, and he told me their champagne was on ice, which did cause me to laugh a lot when they lost. So what happened then at the European Court of Human Rights? Just a couple of points to start. The DNA profiles, the samples and fingerprints were all considered personal data and so fell under the Data Protection Convention, which wasn't a surprise. But previously the European Court had distinguished between DNA and fingerprints because they said that genetic material had obviously a lot greater future potential uses than fingerprints. They actually changed their position in Essen-Marper, and they said, no, we're going to count it all as the same, all of equal weighting. So they actually said that fingerprints contain external identification features, much like photos or voice samples, and so the same general approach should be taken with fingerprints, DNA, voice samples, photographs, and so on. That fingerprints are capable of affecting privacy, and so their retention without consent cannot be regarded as neutral or insignificant. This was a big shock to the police because they weren't even thinking that the European Court of Human Rights were going to say this about fingerprints, that the police couldn't retain fingerprints. And this has really put the cat among the pigeons because, of course, the police fingerprint database is 8.5 million and is generally seen as being non-controversial, that the police can have all these fingerprints and that's not seen as controversial. So I've picked out a couple of quotes from the judgment. It's very interesting judgment in general if you are interested in privacy and so forth. But this is what the European Court of Human Rights said. They said the protection afforded by Article 8 will be unacceptably weakened if the use of modern scientific techniques in the criminal justice system were allowed at any cost and without carefully balancing the potential benefits of the extensive use of such techniques against important private life benefits. I said weighty reasons would have to be put forward by the government before the court could regard as justified a difference in treatment of the applicant's private data compared to that of other unconvicted people. So they're saying there's these group of people called innocent individuals who haven't been convicted of anything, and you can't treat differently those that have simply been arrested and keep their DNA. So they said the question remains whether such retention is proportionate and strikes a fair balance between the competing public and private interests. In this respect, the court is struck by the blanket and indiscriminate nature of the power of retention in England and Wales. So it was the fact that it was just a blanket rule and didn't discriminate between individuals that they were upset about. And of course, the police or the government use this argument, oh, but there's nothing to fear being on the database, because as long as you don't commit any crimes, nothing bad happens to you. And the court actually rejected that argument and said the mere retention and storing of personal data by public authorities, however obtained, are to be regarded as having a direct impact on the private life interest of an individual concerned, irrespective of whether subsequent use is made of the data. So they said even if it's in a dusty old filing cabinet somewhere not used, it is still important. So they said, in this case, the retention at issue constitutes a disproportionate interference and cannot be regarded as necessary in a democratic society. So a resounding blow. It was a unanimous ruling for the government. A couple of days later, the Home Secretary gave a speech in which she outlined there was going to be a common sense approach. It strikes me as something that probably came out of a focus group somewhere, that this appeals to the public, talking about common sense, because at no point anywhere has anyone ever mentioned or articulated what a common sense approach might be. So she said, where surveillance powers are used, are they kept in proportion to the damage and the threat they are seeking to prevent? Perhaps the toughest question of all, does it stand up to the test of common sense? No one has any idea what the hell she was talking about. Don't know what a test of common sense is. And then she threw in some other adjectives: safeguards, openness, proportionality, and common sense. This is the first and last time the government ever used the word proportionality. And of course, they didn't mention common sense again after this either. So in May then, we had a wonderful consultation document, which, as you can see from the title of it, was completely impartial, keeping the right people on the DNA database, was what it was called, and they outlined this proposal. Basically, the point being that if you were innocent of a non-serious offence, you would have your DNA kept for 6 years. If you were innocent of a serious offence, you would have it kept for 12 years. And then there was all these other complicated rules, so complicated that a government minister, when questioned about it, couldn't actually get it right himself. Of course, the one thing that everyone with half a brain will instantly point out is what the Human Genetics Commission said. It is unintelligible to claim an entitlement to hold a profile from one person for longer than that of another on the basis of a difference in kind between two crimes of which they're both equally presumed to be innocent. If you haven't committed a serious crime, why would it be kept for 12 years rather than you haven't committed a minor crime for 6 years? The consultation document was just an embarrassment. I wouldn't urge any of you to read it. It doesn't do the British government any good at all. It failed to tackle important issues, never mentioned accountability, didn't look at the removals process. It didn't at all consider the possibility of individualising risk. It still went ahead with its blanket approach to what can we tell about people who've been arrested. They exaggerated the impact of the National DNA Database. They created an awful lot of confusions. It was very badly written. They used emotive anecdotes. The foreword had been written by the victim of one of those young ladies put up there saying, oh, you need the DNA database to catch horrible people who killed my daughter. Well, yes, we won't argue with that, but this isn't really the place for that kind of emotive anecdote. They also used in their arrest as a proxy for offending. So they talked about people who've been arrested and then offenders in the same sentence, automatically assuming they were one and the same thing. That if you were looking for the weighty reasons, you'd have been disappointed. There were none. There was no principles talked about or discussed. In fact, a complete lack of any principled basis. And there was a general, if you look for inconsistency, anybody who knows anything about the law will know that there are different rules about the rehabilitation of offenders, particularly the sex offenders register. When you get convicted of a sexual offence, you get put on the sex offender register. But there is a regime in place which recognises that you could be rehabilitated and that you come off that register after a certain amount of time. Of course, this kind of idea was completely ignored in this consultation paper. The idea was once an offender, always an offender, we're keeping your DNA. So it's inconsistent. The evidence base they used, which was quite interesting, because in 2006 the Home Office Minister had said, and this is quite honest, as far as we know, there's no definitive data on whether people arrested but not proceeded against are more likely to offend than the population at large. So, of course, the difficulty is now they've got to find some. So what they did was they went along to the Jill Dando Institute in the University College London and asked them to quickly find some evidence. And so they cobbled together, is the politest way of putting it, some data on re-arrest rates. So they looked at people who were arrested and then how long did it take before they were re-arrested. I can't explain what they did anymore, because it was just awful and possibly just didn't make any sense at all. In fact, a very well-respected scientific journalist said in a national newspaper that it was possibly the most unclear and poorly presented piece of research I've ever seen in a professional environment. It was incomprehensible and unreadable. It made me feel a whole lot better, because I'd spent like a week looking at it going, oh my God, I don't understand this, thinking I was being stupid. So what they looked at, again, this is of conflating re-arrest rates with offending. In fact, a later government paper said they admitted that there was going to be a false positive rate when retaining data for 6 years of 3/5. So of those people that would be retained for 6 years, 3/5 of them wouldn't actually go on to be re-arrested. But that was seen as acceptable. It was a real stretch to marry the data that they actually produced in this paper with the proposals. There wasn't really any link you could make at all. And the Human Genetics Commission, of course, pointed out there was no discernible systematic attempt made to evaluate the utility of the database on the basis of robust and complete evidence. We were still lacking an evidence base. In fact, it became so bad that the director of the Jill Dando Institute actually went on the Today programme on Radio 4 and basically distanced herself as far away as she could from the paper, saying it had been done too quickly, they didn't have access to the data, and she said, you might as well stick your finger in the air and think of a number. So she didn't actually think of a lot of her own paper either. So there had been all these proposals put in the Policing and Crime Bill. Suddenly, the day before the parliamentary debates on it, they said, OK, we'll take all those out, we'll come forward with some more proposals. So they came up then, some months later, with 14 new sections to be inserted into the Police and Criminal Evidence Act, and also some minor tweaks to the governance. So this then was going to be their new revamped retention regime. Basically, they took out the 12 years and just said everybody arrested but unconvicted 6 years. Of course, this didn't really get around all the other issues. It just removed that kind of distinction between the 12 years and the 6 years, which was obviously an error, but 6 years wasn't a whole lot better. So it was still wildly unpopular. The Joint Committee on Human Rights, the parliamentary committee, wrote a scathing report on this. They said that government was pushing the boundaries of MARPA. They said that this regime was still disproportionate and potentially arbitrary. They had licked their finger and stuck it in the air to find a number. That they'd completely discounted any stigma that might be attached to innocent people being on the DNA database. You never saw any mention of that. The presumption of innocence never got mentioned, and so forth. And they had simply failed to demonstrate that it was necessary for them to have this data. So we still lacked principles, we still had a lot of opposition. Interestingly, around the same time, the European Court of Human Rights actually heard another case from the Netherlands about the retention of DNA, and they ruled that the DNA retention was okay if you'd been convicted of an offence for a prescribed period related to the sentence for that offence. So this is quite different again now, because, of course, in the UK, there was never any question about convicted people having their DNA retained. It was just, you're convicted, don't care of what, you get your DNA kept. And, of course, that's now being questioned as well. So my plea then was really just, can we have our balancing act back, please? It was a massive disappointment with our response to MARPA. Not just a disappointment, but really embarrassment. It was embarrassing. The Prime Minister said in the House of Commons around this time, we need a national debate on this, which just beggared belief, because we've had like 4 or 5 parliamentary committee reports on it. We've had the Human Genetics Commission have done citizen juries. We've had TV programmes on it. We've had media debates on it. We've had report after report after report on it. I can't think of much more that's been more debated in the UK. I don't know what we have to do to have a national debate about something if this hasn't been debated. So the principles that were espoused by the government now, they've stopped talking about common sense and they talk about public protection. They talk about public protection and risk avoidance. So they talk very much about, if we don't have this DNA, there'll be rapists walking the street. Like they're not already, but this is the general idea. We need this DNA to get murderers and rapists off the street. They fail to mention that the DNA database is most often used for burglars and car thieves because they don't sound as scary. So they talk about public protection. And they've done a wonderful trick. The Home Secretary, the latest one, said public protection also means delivering on our commitment to the human rights of the individual. So whereas we had a balancing act of public protection and civil liberties, so human rights of the individual, they've said, oh, no, this is all included in public protection. So because we're interested in public protection, we're also looking after human rights within that, and so we don't need a balancing act. So we still have in the UK what can arguably be called an indiscriminate blanket approach. There's been no individualisation of risk. Individual circumstances are not taken into consideration. If you're someone who gets arrested regularly, you're a drug abuser, you've been caught umpteen times doing something yet not convicted, that has no bearing on whether you have your DNA taken versus a middle-aged housewife who was wrongly arrested trying to return, this is a real case, trying to return a jumper to a store that she'd bought, and there was some confusion and they thought she'd stolen the jumper. She got arrested and then about an hour later common sense prevailed and they realised she was only returning a jumper. So her DNA is kept, as is the drug user. So no individualisation of risk. I think this is going to become more of an issue, particularly because internationally we are still out of step with most countries. Of the global DNA samples that are kept in the world, the UK has nearly a third of them. And you have to remember, I'm sure you all remember, but people from the UK forget, we're tiny. There's hardly any of us. We're really, really small and insignificant. So the fact that we have a third of the global collection of DNA samples is shocking. No one's really talked about proportionality. Do we need all of this DNA? The necessity argument has been ignored, and we haven't got the evidence base to talk about it. The examples we've had of evidence have been shockingly bad. The government, I think, are risking an awful lot. They're risking public confidence in the national DNA database, which is fundamental. They're risking our consent to this database and to policing in general, which is how our policing system is run. People are becoming cynical about the DNA database now because it is coming to the fore that really it's not all it's cracked up to be. It only solved in 2006-07, 0.35% of crimes had a DNA sample, a DNA match available. So it's really not doing all that well. And of course, it is going to be open again to legal challenge. And of course, if we are going to be running an illegal database, essentially, then that might be catastrophic for our use of the database internationally. So I think our search for weighty reasons will continue for some time yet. Thank you.